Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today we are taking a look at a Taiwanese T-65 rifle. This is the first AR pattern rifle that was adopted by Taiwan, and it's actually a short-stroke piston gun. I think there are some folks out there who think that the piston ARs began with the HK416, and au contraire, they've been around for quite some time before that. So the first piston gun was actually the Colt 703, dating all the way back to 1969. And then there have been a variety of, guns like this one ever since. Anyway, let's start with a little bit of backstory here. Taiwan, which is the island off the coast of China, a large island off the coast of China, at the end of the Chinese Civil War in 1949, the nationalist elements in China suffered a series of defeats and pushbacks, and eventually evacuated mainland China and took refuge on Taiwan, where they set up a nationalist government on Taiwan, and the Chinese Communist Party was never able to actually invade the island and finish the war and fully defeat the nationalists. And so what we end up with to this day are essentially two separate Chinas: the nationalist government on the island of, well, on Taiwan, the island of Formosa, and the communist government running mainland China. Obviously, there's all sorts of current events, implications to that, which we're going to leave out for the time being. But the U.S. government had always supported the nationalist side in the Chinese Civil War. Interesting little side note here. You think about the Korean War. The United Nations sent troops into Korea where they were actively fighting against Chinese troops. Why was it that, you know, China's in the UN? Why didn't China veto this? Well, it's because at the time, the recognized Chinese government represented in the UN was the nationalist government in Taiwan. Anyway, the United States has always supported the Taiwanese government, and that includes small arms. Taiwan bought a whole bunch of ARs in the 1960s, and then they actually adopted the M14, one of very few countries to do so, as their Type 57. Now, any of these Taiwanese type designations, they do refer to a year of adoption, but they're based on the Chinese calendar of, which is based on the year of the Chinese Revolution, which is 1911. So to convert a Taiwanese designation to a Gregorian Western calendar year, you add 11 to it. So the Type 57 M14 is actually 1968. The U.S. government actually sold Taiwan a bunch of tooling from the old H&R M14 production line. Taiwan used it to manufacture a whole slew of M14s. But before too long, they decided that they really wanted a 5.56 rifle. That's the way that NATO was going. That's what the U.S. was doing. And in order to keep pace, Taiwan wanted to do the same thing. And so in 1973, they start a development project for their own AR-based gun. They wanted to manufacture this domestically for obvious reasons. And first prototypes were ready in 1975. 1976, they formally adopt the rifle as, of course, the Type 65. Once again, we're going to take the Taiwanese designation, add 11 to it, or subtract 11 from the year of adoption to get the designation. So that is our T-65 rifle right here. And for the record, this isn't an original one. This is a clone build because a number of parts kits for these came into hkparts.net, where I believe they actually still have some because the price is really quite high by most people's standards. So they haven't sold all that fast. But I thought it was way too cool and interesting and unusual of a gun to not get in on. So given that there are, I believe, two original authentic actual T-65s in this country right now, and they're both dealer sample machine guns, we're going to go ahead and take a closer look at this one. So let's dive right into it. At the highest level, the T-65 is basically a Taiwanese version of the M16A1. It follows a lot of the same layout concepts as the M16A1. Of course, it has a 20-inch barrel out here. The profile is the same as the M16A1. The muzzle device is the same as the M16A1. The rifling twist is the same as the M16A1. It's a 1-in-12-inch twist barrel that was designed for the original 55-grain 5.56 cartridge. The whole rifle is relatively light. It comes in at 3.3 kilos, which is about 7.25 pounds. So it's handy, it's light. Again, very much like a Taiwanese version of the M16A1. It does use standard M16 AR pattern magazines. I'm going to take that out so we can get a little bit closer up into the gun here. Obviously, the distinctive element visually is this upper assembly. It doesn't have a carry handle, but it does have the sight lifted up to the same height so that you get the same effect as with the M16A1. You have a straight line stock, recoil comes straight back here, right into the shoulder of the shooter. That controls, prevents most muzzle climb from happening, and then you have sights that are lifted up to eye level. In a mechanical sense, what makes this really distinct from the M16 is the fact that it is a short-stroke gas-piston system. It's the gas-piston essentially off the AR-18, which is essentially the gas-piston off the SVT Tokarev rifle. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of the features. Of course, we have the birdcage muzzle device out here, same as on the M16. We have a pretty standard elevation adjustable, so threaded in and out front sight post, but we also have a really big, chunky night sight that would originally, I believe, have been like a luminous paint. Today it's just, it's all the radioactivity is gone, all the paint's actually worn off, so it's just a white front sight there, and that snaps up and down when you want it and when you don't. We have a pretty thin and kind of flimsy feeling and kind of loose handguard here, which we'll take off in a moment. Note that this screw is a replacement part. A lot of the parts kits that came in were missing this screw, so HK Parts replaced them with just a generic screw that has the same thread pattern. So the finish is wrong, but the carry handle here is gone. Of course, on the original ARs, the carry handle was intended primarily as a protective cover for the charging handle that was located up here. And when the charging handle moved to the back, the carry handle just stayed in place because, well, it was already there. The Taiwanese, since they were making their own new upper receiver dies and forgings, they had no reason to keep that extra material, so they got rid of it. The rear sight is a two-position aperture, much like the M16A1. This big old wheel is windage adjustment, and all it does is screw that aperture piece left and right. And then we have our rear night sight, two really big white dots that are no longer luminous in any way, and that just folds down when you're not using it. Standard AR dust cover. Note that there are no gas vent holes in the bolt carrier because there's no gas coming in here. We'll get to that in a moment when we take it apart. There is no forward assist. There is also no brass deflector. So very early AR sort of elements there. The charging handle is basically identical to an AR. It's got a locking catch on the left side. Works just like an AR. Pistol grip is pretty well worn on this example. It's, again, an early style AR pistol grip. No finger groove on it there. The buttstock has a bit different shape than we're used to on an AR, which is, I don't know, neither better nor worse, really. It's just, it's a buttstock. It does its job. The rear sling swivel here is kind of neat in that it is clearly inspired by the M14. So it will pivot over, so if you're carrying the rifle flat across your back, the sling comes up from the side. Or if you're carrying it over your shoulder, the sling comes down here. Again, you see that on the M1 Garand and the M14. And then we have a steel trapdoor in the butt plate. There's a little storage compartment in there for cleaning kit and such. The original T65s had a three-position selector switch, safe, semi, and full. When they replaced these rifles with an upgraded version in the 1980s, the T65K2, they would add a three-round burst as well, but that was not on the original guns. The receiver markings here are very simplistic. It's just rifle, 5.56mm T65, and a serial number. This is a reproduction lower, courtesy of Intl Mil Co, which is super cool. They have their actual legal markings there on the inside of the trigger group, and so that allows them to make a variety of clone-style receivers with proper markings. So big thanks to them for helping me out with one of these T65 receivers. Disassembly here is just like an AR. We're going to pull the rear pin out. That allows me to pivot the upper and lower apart. In fact, I'm going to pull the front pin as well. We'll just pop the upper and the lower off. The lower is essentially just straight up standard AR-15. I will point out that the buffers on these take this out. This uses a rifle length, rifle size buffer. This is the original one that came with my kit. This was originally soft rubber. This is no longer rubber. This is now like hardened rubber powder. We've got some weights in there, but if you use this, if you try and shoot with this thing, this is going to disintegrate into powder, the weights are going to fall out, and the gun is just going to stop running on you. So for me, when I actually shoot this, I have a modern rifle buffer that I put in it instead. But it's cool to have the original Taiwanese one. The buttstock is held on by the top buttstock screw. If I take that screw out, there it is. I can then pull the buttstock off the back of the rifle. There's our buffer tube with its threaded hole on the end to lock in. We got the detent spring here for the rear takedown pin. That's pretty much all there is to the lower. Moving on to the upper, disassembles again, just like an AR. There are a number of differences you can immediately see on the bolt. There's a solid lug up here for the piston to hit. There are no gas vents here. Firing pin comes out. This disassembles just like an AR bolt. Note, however, there are no gas rings on the back of the bolt because no gas is coming back in here. Normally, you'd have gas rings and you would have essentially a gas piston built into the back end of the bolt carrier. That's how the standard AR works. Not so much on the T65 because it's got its gas piston up here. So we'll go ahead and take the handguard off. That screw and its retaining plate come off, and then the upper handguard just lifts off. Note that there is no heat shield in here. There's just like reflective paint, I guess, and hopes and prayers in there to keep it cool. It does get hot. This is one of the elements that they would improve on later patterns of the T65 and later rifle developments. The barrel nut here is a little bit different than a standard AR. Tightens down, but then you've got this plate over the front of it that positions the gas piston here. So gas is tapped out of the front sight block right there, where it goes into this system, and it is going to push this element back like so. And you can see the piston right there on the inside of the upper receiver. That is pushing on this lug right here. So that's essentially how it operates. We can take this apart to its component pieces. And again, this is essentially the exact same technology that went into the Tokarev or the AR-18. There we go. We've got three pieces of the piston and its return spring. And then there is the actual, this is the fixed element of the gas piston coming off of the gas block. There's the whole thing stripped. These were formally adopted by the Taiwanese military and they were used for a couple of decades. They're no longer still in use anywhere. They've been replaced in Taiwan by newer patterns of AR rifle. The Taiwanese did find a fair number of relatively small export contracts for these as well. Some of them in the Middle East. They went to Libya, they went to Liberia, some of them went to Jordan, and then actually a bunch of contracts in Central and South America. So in particular, these went to El Salvador, Panama, Guatemala, Haiti, Paraguay, probably a couple other countries in the region. And as a result, they've shown up in a number of conflicts in that region. Some of them have shown up in the Middle East and North Africa because of some of their African sales. These particular parts kits, I believe, came in from somewhere in Latin America. We've seen a number of things come in from Guatemala in the last few years, so maybe these were Guatemalan, but I can't say for sure. I think they're a particularly cool and unusual pattern of rifle, and I think now it's time to go ahead and take this one out to the range and do some shooting with it.
You know what does not really blend in Arizona? Taiwanese Marine Corps camouflage, but that's okay because it blends in beautifully with the T65. Ow. 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 Woo, just barely. Ow. Let me get a... So that's why the case buffer exists on ARs. Now, I should be able to tweak the extractor spring, I believe, to prevent it from doing that, to kick it out a little farther over. But really, this is from that generation of guns that were simply not designed to be shot left-handed, because left-handers were intended to just be retrained to shoot right-handed. The handguard's getting a little toasty up here. Like, there's a lot of hot gas ejecting out from that short gas piston system, but it's running nice and reliably. It's comfortable to shoot. It's a lightweight gun. It's like, this is like the M16A1 with a short stroke piston conversion in it, which is kind of cool. One potential issue that I'm seeing here is with the front sight, through your rear aperture, that front sight post looks really quite similar to those two little protective wings. On the M16 series, we're used to those wings having a nice curvature out that makes them more easy to just distinguish quickly from the front sight post. This one, not so much, especially when I'm switching shoulders and shooting weak hand, weak eye. I have to take more time to identify that, yes, I am in fact looking at the front sight. And
that's exactly what I was gonna say.
So I got one magazine left. Let's try the gigantic night sights built into the gun. Those were probably originally luminous. They are certainly not luminous anymore. It's been a bit too long. I mean, they work. Not very precise, but they work. Certainly easier to pick up than the regular sights. Excuse the fact that I am literally dripping sweat here. It's like, I think it's about 105 or 107 today out at the range. But we're doing this for you guys. Ah, whoa, that's really hot up there. Whew, toasty. All right, I'm gonna empty this mag and then we're gonna get out of the sun. This has been a really fun gun to shoot. It's a fantastically cool piece of history. Really cool that these parts kits came in. There weren't many of them, but there were enough for me to jump on one myself.